God in heaven, we ask that you hear this prayer and be with all of us as we go through the business of today's agenda. Dear Father God in heaven, we ask that you hear this prayer on behalf of everyone in the room. Dear Father God in heaven, we ask that you hear this prayer and hear that you be with us, be among us, be with us. Dear Father God in heaven, I ask this prayer in the Son's name, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
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 So the food is ready now. So we're going to move on first with the gala committee, and I can wait. You're eating. I can move to another one. Okay. gala committee report and the gala committee update.
Good morning, Tabor neighbors.
Good morning.
All right, so I want to ask for a show of hands and keep your hands up as I'm going to ask a series of questions. So who went to the gala last year, the Tabor gala last year? Great, keep your hand up. Who heard about all the people who had a great time at the gala last year? Awesome. Who wants to help keep the gala this year really great and fun? All right, you're all volunteers. Thank you.
No.
Get their names.
All right, I got y'all. Okay. So I am the chair of the gala again this year. We had a fabulous year last year and really looking to continue the success and recognition of the Crystal Awardees and also the great scholarships that that Tabor gives to well-deserving students in our community. And so, therefore, we need help with raising money. And that means helping with auction items and dessert dash items. And there are many other ways to help, too, with the volunteer committee, for instance. So we this year have broken up the committee into several subcommittees. And so with a few that we need particular help on. So one of the highlights last year was we introduced the dessert dash, which Mo just gave a little preview about. And the way the dessert dash works is when you walk into the gala, you will see two full tables of just amazing, beautiful desserts of all kinds. And at the end, and so while you're eating at the gala dinner, each table will be collectively bidding on desserts. And the tables with the highest total amount gets to go first and pick the dessert of their choice. So that means we have to get about 40 desserts donated to us and delivered to the venue on the day up. So I have some sign-up sheets that I'm gonna run around and share, and feel free to, you can personally, oh, thanks, Ann. You can sign up to purchase a dessert from your favorite bakery. You can go to your favorite bakery and ask for a donation, and then you can pick it up on the day and bring it with you to the gala. Or you can help with just transporting. And we have some extra flyers here if you know others, or if you need a flyer to hand to a baker to say, this is what I'm working on, this is what I'm asking for, this might help. So, Mo, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, so I think, frankly, I have the easiest job of all. Because when you walk...
The sweetest job.
Huh?
The sweetest job.
sweetest job. That's a piece of cake, really.
Yeah, thanks.
So, because everybody, when they walk into the venue and they see all those desserts, they're thinking about them the whole night. People are competitive and they're bidding, and everybody loves desserts. Thank you. Sorry about that. Everybody loves desserts. So, like she mentioned, you can. I don't usually have trouble being heard, but thank you. So you can donate, you can connect with your favorite bakery, and if you have any questions, please connect with me. I'll have my business card here today. I'm very motivated, and it's a really easy way to participate before you come, and then just come and relax. So please connect with me if you have any questions. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to hand it off to Frank, who's leading the silent auction. And then other than the silent and live auction committee, we also need volunteers to help during the event. So Yan can take your name if you're interested in that.
Well, good morning. I'm the lead for both the live and the silent auction for this year. Last year we didn't have one, and we're going to do a little rearranging of the layout of the reception area, so we're going to be able to accommodate a silent auction downstairs. And there's two ways that you can lend your support. First of all, you can donate any item you feel would attract bidders, you know, something you personally like. And I have a bestsellers list. I'm going to pass out the donation form, and my email address is on there. And if you want a bestseller list for auction items, just drop me an email. The second way you can support is to solicit donations, and you'll be of great assistance in soliciting auction items from friends, business associates, even your own employer. You know, when you're out dining at the restaurant, ask the manager or the owner for a donation, hand him a donation form. It's always important to hand that person a donation form. I'm going to hand one to somebody here today, and I'm quite sure I'm going to get a donation from that gentleman that always donates. So when you're having your car service, ask the owner and the manager to donate, hand him the form. Soliciting is really fun. It's a no-cost situation for you to be able to support Tabor 100. And we can really use your help this year because we had, you know, 1 year of no auction. So keep auction forms in your car, and if you have any challenges downloading the donation form from the Tabor homepage, drop me an email and I'll be happy to send one to you. And in closing, we're looking for your support. Any questions for me? Great, thank you. Have a great morning.
Thank you. I had a thought that I forgot. Oh, for all of you all from Olympia, there's that place. Every time I meet somebody for lunch, you all have me to meet you there. And they got all of these cakes and desserts. Whack. There you go. Just think, if everybody that's sitting here from Olympia bring a cake from there, the desserts are. And I go, why do they have me to meet them here for lunch? That's it, Wagner's. It was another thought I had and I've lost it. That's over 20, okay. Government Affairs, is there a report today?
This report will be pretty quick. If you don't know, the initiative 1644 for Comanche Country was in this last week of signature gathering. The deadline is July 6th. If you have not signed it, please sign. And if you have them on you, mail them in, because as soon as they count, as soon as they assess, know where they're at. We don't know if it's going to make it or not, but whether it does, there's been a good movement out there, led by Jesse Weinberry and a lot of other volunteers. So whether this thing makes it or falls short, we want to make sure we carry this momentum into throughout November into the next session. So there's been a big, good movement. The awareness has been increasing. People are waking up and realizing how bad I-200 has done to been for us in our communities. So we got to keep just building off of this. So keep helping. We'll put a newsletter, we'll put an announcement out next week, see if we made it or not. But if not, then we do have some contingencies to make sure that this gets passed within the next year or so. So I want to talk about other plans we have until we know what the results is for the signature gathering, but when that happens, we'll be sure to update you. But things are going well. There is a lot of momentum building out this, and a lot of awareness, and we are making waves out there and making a lot of momentum. So thanks for everyone that's been helping us. What's up with this?
Yeah, I always call on people when they're eating, as they're getting their food.
Well, we have Mr. Weinberry here actually, personally, so he can actually give an update and some numbers on what's going on with 1644 himself. So we'll get straight from the source once he's finished eating.
I have a question.
Yes.
If I may. I got information about this initiative, about how important it is, the Port of Seattle, but it came via information that it appeared El Centro de la Raza was the initiator of this initiative. I was going to ask that question today, but I think you've answered it. It isn't, right? It isn't El Centro de la Raza. It is truly a multi organization, and the reason why I'm asking the question, and I know you probably answered it perfect, it is great that any organization is fighting I-200, but it is important for us doing the work we do that it is a multi-minority community organization. So the answer is probably yes, but I it came in almost, El Centro is doing this, so.
Yeah, El Centro is one of the top contributors for this. I think if you look at the bottom of on the initiative or any other paperwork that 1644 has, you'll see El Centro de la Raza, Tabor 100, I think LACP, and I can't think of the other two, but usually the top five contributors, and right. El Centro is one of them.
I will make that very clear Monday.
And NAMAC, yeah.
Jesse.
Mr. Weinberry, give us a quick direct update on the status of 1644 and on.
Thank you, Rial, and thank you, everyone here at Tabor. I'm going to be really quick because I have to head to a meeting with the Washington Federation of State Employees. They have close to 70,000 members across the state. They are doing a digital petition drive, which I will briefly explain, and their board of directors is meeting to vote on getting that out today. So, in a nutshell, Wednesday we were at 89,000 names. I'm told now that another 10,000 has been added statewide, so we're at 99,000 names. I'm one that likes to round, okay? I'm gonna call it 100,000, all right? But it started right here. When I say it, I'm talking about the whole movement to overturn I-200. It has been a statewide, multicultural, cross-gender movement, but Tabor 100 was founded by Tabor in the aftermath of the passage of I-200 to overturn I-200 20 years ago. And so the seed you planted two decades ago is now sprouting. Roughly 100,000 people believe in this issue. I'm just going to pass out the new handout that we have going, accompanies the initiative. And I'll just quickly say that you can go that center back.
Thanks.
And go on the side. I'll just say that either Wednesday or Thursday, whenever Kennedy resigned, what was that? Wednesday, okay. It changed everything. Many of you who have not been following affirmative action may not know his connection to affirmative action. It was Kennedy who wrote the last decision on affirmative action, which was Fisher versus the University of Texas. He wrote the majority opinion that kept affirmative action. To sum up about a 120-page majority opinion, he basically said, as long as racial discrimination exists in America, we need to use race as a remedy for that discrimination. Common sense, but it came from, you know, a jurist. Now, you need to understand that God had a whole lot to do, whatever God you believe in, that God had a whole lot to do with us still having affirmative action after that case. Who was on the court who died while the case was being considered, but obviously died before it was handed down. Scalia, where do you think his vote would have been? Okay, this was not a 5-4 decision. That's usually what you get from a 9-member panel on the Supreme Court. This was like 4-3. And you say, well, wait a minute, that only adds up to 7. So you take Scalia out, where's the other person? Kagan, who was appointed by Obama, recused herself from voting at all. Because as Solicitor General, she had dealt with the very case at the lower level before she was elevated, all right? So when you do the numbers, you put Scalia back in, you still have Kagan recusing herself, affirmative action is gone, all right? So we still have it, and the most important thing that Ali and I were talking about yesterday is that we have to keep it in the states, because chances are, I mean, we all know this, nothing's being hidden these days, Trump is going to appoint someone who is to the left, I mean, sorry, to the right. Yeah, in our dream. Right. To the right. You're right, my, yeah, you're right. Okay. You're right, my right. To the right of center, they are not going to be for maintaining affirmative action, and it's going to be gone on the federal level. So your only chance is what is in the U.S. Constitution, and that's what's called states' rights. So we can do what we want in Washington State. Thank God the petition is on its way. We have a good chance of putting it on the ballot so we can put it into law before the Trump appointment happens. But that's where we are in our history here. And so I just want to thank you again. As we all have said, let's push 100% to July 6th. And if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Thank you.
And I think if anyone hasn't signed, Henry had one today to sign. And we sent out an email where you can go and print off the signature form to go gather signatures. Did everyone get a copy of that? And with a code, if you need, you can go to Kinko's and give that code and they'll print it off for you for no charge. I sent that out to membership. We need everyone out there gathering signatures.
Kevin, education. Good morning. Just a quick update on the scholarships for Table 100. As was mentioned during our gala, we award 5 scholarships from programs that Table 100 manages, and over the spring, the Education Committee has been working on developing that list of scholars. Out of the 5 scholarship programs, we have scholars selected or renewed for at least 4 of them. And that would be the Mel Streeter Scholarship, the Green Energy Scholarship, and 2 Space Needle Scholarships. We have 3 PEMCO scholarships that we renew with Seattle University. I'll be meeting with them over the next month to renew the scholars who are currently continuing in the 2018-2019 school year, or if we need to select another new freshman coming in for the fall of 2018, then we will do that. And then our last meeting will be with University of Washington and their School of Business to select a new Bradford scholar, because the previous scholar graduated in June. We've had a really solid level of performance by our scholars. The vast majority of them graduate and move on, so we'll be looking forward to introducing to you another slate of scholars for 2018-2019. Thank you.
Any questions for Kevin? Henry, do you have anything public?
I don't have anything.
Okay. And we're doing something new right now with the website, right? And
yes.
And sending our email. You're going to talk about both? Okay. Alrighty. Next, we'll move into our speakers, and first we have Lewis from the court.
He's coming. No, he don't. He's here.
Oh, I'm next. Hello, everyone. Again, well, hello. Hello. I want to talk about a great story, which is truly an opportunity for small businesses in the Seattle area and the Puget Sound to learn from others that have made it, and also maybe share with others. So that's the great story that I have here on the screen, the conference. But before I do that, I'd like to take a moment of privilege and just say thank you to a good friend and a good, an amazing professional, Teresa Berntsen of OMWBE, who's moving on to the OL, Department of Licensing as Director, and she's badly needed there, a department that has a lot of issues, and she will be the right person to work with those. And welcome, Lisa, at OMWBE as well. I know there'll be more, but it's a great group, and you'll find a lot of love, and also a lot of pushback when needed, so just be prepared. They're not shy. So the Port of Seattle, but in particular, Lance Little, our amazing director at SeaTac Airport, talked to me last year, May or so, about hosting a national conference on minority business opportunities. And the organization that he had talked with is AMAC, the Airport Minority Advisory Council. So Lance said, Louis, do you think that we are ready for this? SeaTac Airport and the port had gone through some issues with minority and lack of the needle moving in the right direction. But I said, you know, bring it. Let's bring that national organization to Seattle, and then let's continue to do what we do and see what we can do. So this is what this conference is. The Inspiring Possibilities Conference, Charlene, I'm going to ask, is the title. We created that name because Seattle, Pacific Northwest, is a place where possibilities become reality. Boeing, Microsoft, Starbucks, your company. So the title is fitting. The Airport Minority Advisory Council, or AMAC, is an organization that has a long history of supporting minority businesses. Blacks in Government, AMAC, COMPTO, many of those organizations were born out of this 1970s fight for affirmative action, and AMAC decided to remain focused on airport opportunities. The airport industry is very enormous, billions and billions of dollars across the country. About 300 airports are considered medium and large airports. There's about 2,000 airports in general once you add the general aviation airports, but there's a lot of money. So the conference will be in Seattle on August 21st through the 24th at the Westin Hotel. There'll be about 1,000 professionals coming in to, I'm gonna move where you can see it. 1,000 professionals will be flying in, and many from our local communities attending. These are folks that do this every year. The conference last year was in Houston. The year before was in Cleveland. Next year, they'll be announcing where the conference is next year, but it is always focused around aerospace and aviation business and career development. We want more minorities doing business with airports and more minorities engaged in the management of airports. The sessions will include a variety of subjects from how to do business with airports to public issue, policy issues, and the impact that it has on the entire aviation. And the airport industry advocates have been at the forefront of both affirmative action and civil rights to be included in the airport management, not only for business purposes, but as passengers, our civil rights need to be protected. We all use the airport, most people do. We all use the airport in one form or another. So the airports are truly a place where all of those aspects are covered. So AMAC, as mentioned, is the only national nonprofit association dedicated to promoting minority-owned, women-owned businesses in the airport sector and aerospace sector, and in particular finding opportunities for DBEs and ACDBEs, Airport Concessions Disadvantaged Business Enterprise. Those are the two certification types, DBE and ACDBE. And the ACDBE is what gives minority and women owners an opportunity to make it big, because at SeaTac Airport, we have 47 million passengers, customers, for those small business owners that sell stuff at the airport.
and you have a ready-made customer base. You just need to be good at what you do if you're one of the chosen companies. And AMAC works with Congress. They are based in DC. In fact, they're based in the same building as COMTO. Does anyone know what COMTO is? COMTO is the Conference of Minorities in Transportation, another 1970s organization. And AMAC and COMTO are in the same building. They work very well with Congress. They are at the, in the Hill. They do a couple of conferences in Washington where congressmen and women and senators attend on issues related to minority opportunities at the airport, but they also work with other organizations to support each other. The Westin Hotel is the host hotel, and this is one way where minorities can tell the city of Seattle, we are here, the hotel is sold out, and the bookings by minorities traveling to Seattle is another show how minorities not only are looking for opportunities, but we can create economic impact. We calculated the economic impact of the minorities coming to this conference. It's about $2.5 million for the city of Seattle in a couple of days. So we are also tourists, we're also conference goers, and we're also contributors. Those are just a couple of photos from last year. Why Seattle? SeaTac concessions and the capital program at SeaTac Airport, $2 billion of capital program, and the concessions program, which is enormous. You walk through the airport and you'll see a lot of construction going on. Opportunities are being created, and Lance Little and our commissioners want more minorities, more women owners, more local businesses, small businesses taking opportunities at the airport, because it is a great opportunity that we you can make it. You can make a lot of money. There is no shame in saying you're making a lot of money as a concessionaire, minority or woman owned business. And then AMAC has been interested in expanding to the West Coast. They're really big on the East Coast and in the central parts of the U.S. in Atlanta and Chicago. They're not coming to the West Coast because I know they can recruit more members. And the economic opportunities that conferences bring to the city, to the region, that we, Port of Seattle, can take pride in saying we brought economic opportunities, I mean contribution with minorities. Highlights, we have a youth career day. It's called Project Lift. 100 youth from high schools, the local high schools, from all high schools basically, will be spending up one day at the Museum of Flight on August 20th, that's a Tuesday. They will be exposed to leaders from around the country who are minority and women, and August 21st. And they'll be exposed to leaders, and they will be seeing themselves as the future directors of airports. Alaska Airlines has minority pilots, Delta Airlines and others, they'll be seeing themselves. These are our kids going through high school, 100 of them for a full day of career day opportunities, and also the future concessionaires at airports. A golf tournament the next day, Wednesday, the 22nd, we'll have a full day at the Willows Run, the youth golf. It's an opportunity to rub elbows with airport directors, with leaders, and owners of big companies like Host Marriott or Hudson News, global companies that work at airports, opportunity to meet them, and also show them how it's done in golf. Welcome to Seattle Reception. That will be a night event at the Bell Harbor. We'll take the entire conference center and have, again, a great party welcoming people from around the country, most of them minorities. And then we'll have other, the Westin Hotel will have training tracks, DBE and ACDBE. The Federal Aviation Administration will be here in full force. We are inviting the administrator of the Small Business Administration to be one of the speakers. The lineup of speakers, which is available online, is becoming really, really great. There'll be some surprise speakers as well, important. Business matchmaking. Matchmaking will invite local businesses to speed date with local primes and national primes to do work in airports. This is your opportunity to expand your work into the airport business. Again, billions and billions and billions of dollars are being spent to upgrade airports around the country. LAX has a 15 to 20 billion capital program. Atlanta and Chicago, they keep announcing billions of dollars in expansion, $2 billion in SeaTac. what you learn to do at one airport as a DBE, you can do at any airport in the country. You can partner with organizations and companies. And then we'll have tours for the visitors. We'll have airport tours and city tours. And then a lot of opportunities for networking and VIP events. We're almost done here. Let's start with some more photos. I will skip the lineup of speakers. We'll go to the next slide. And we'll watch a promotional video and I'll answer any questions. I want to get the music on this one. Not me singing. Promo videos, that's okay. No, no worries about the music. So this promo video is being sent around the country. We're promoting Seattle, we're promoting the Northwest, we're promoting the diversity. And we're promoting the airport industry and obviously all the wonderful things. So our minority partners from across the country will be enjoying a great time August 21st through the 24th. So sorry for the technical glitch, but this is what the conference is. So this is going to start. Any questions? And I'll turn it back over to any questions. And Mel, would you stand up, please? Yeah. Mel is my right hand on this. Her work on this is assisting me and making sure that all issues related to the conference are put together, of course, Charmaine. But Mel is the person that you may want to give your name to. If you want to know more, she'll send you the information. And you got flyers on the paper. Sorry, you had a question.
Seattle is a pretty fast-growing airport. How does it rank nationally compared to other airports with respect to minority participation in the business opportunities?
So on passenger count, we are ninth at 47 million. In minority participation on concessions, we are at 22%, which is average for an airport of our size. Although you go to Atlanta and the percentage is more like 40% in Atlanta, in New York. So, but for our size, we are on average at 22% in concession. In construction and the rest, we really fail because we are still at one digit, like 4%. I-200 is really creating a lot of work. And if I may add one footnote, I learned this week from the Federal Aviation, for any project of the $2 billion we have with federal dollars, they become federally assisted projects. We can only add language that says DBE goals, that we have goals. Once you have that language in the contract, and I imagine this works for other public agencies, and Teresa, maybe you know better than me, but once you have a DBE goal, you cannot even mention local WMBE firms that are not DBE. In other words, for federally assisted projects, we will go and require DBEs, but we cannot promote or outreach to non-DBEs in writing. And the FAA told me to do this, and there is a document they sent me that proves it. So if you're not a DBE, sorry, we're not going to reach out to you. Is it crazy?
Okay. And let me ask you this, though. You can't reach out, but would the goals count or the participation still be inclusive?
The way I read the document is we have a goal of 4% for a project that is federally assisted. And the language, the bids to primes would say your only requirement is to meet the DBE guidelines. We cannot, in the same document, say we hope that you also use minority and women businesses, because the FAA considers that language supporting local businesses, and that's a no-no because the DBE is a federal program.
Right. But my question is, the airport here, there's still a goal, when I say goal, a desire to be inclusive.
Inclusive on non-DBE
right.
projects.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, that was my question.
Yes.
Thank you. And what I also like to tell folks is think out of the box. Just because it says airport and concession, it doesn't mean the only opportunity is construction at the work at the airport or having a concession. So I can see that there could be opportunities for fly ride and photography, for catering, for furniture. In construction, these concessions have to have build out. So think out of the box when we talk about the opportunities in coming to this event and meeting with folks from the airport on airport projects. Don't just, as I say quite a bit, say tunnel vision. Don't be just tunnel vision because this is saying airport. That look at what your products are, what you do, to see how there is an opportunity for your firm. Any questions? Okay, next we're gonna have Michael Charles, and he's gonna talk to us about the initiative 1634.
Thank you all. Hello everybody, my name is Michael Charles. As I said earlier, this is my first Tabor meeting as a business owner, which is exciting for me. I've gone to Tabor a few times before in the past, but always with the local elected officials. So it's exciting to be here today. But what I'm here to talk about today is an upcoming initiative that's gonna affect all of us. It's 1634. It has yet to be on the ballot, but will be soon. And this is the Yes to Affordable Groceries. So essentially, if passed, this initiative will ensure that there's a red line drawn around the groceries in your cart. This is important, especially as, you know, prices continue to rise here in the area. Seattle here, we have some of the highest grocery prices in the country, and it's not like things are getting easier to live here. So essentially what this initiative is gonna ensure that it's not gonna repeal any soda tax that just happened, but it'll make sure that if there is going to be a tax placed on anything in your grocery cart in the future, that it will take a statewide, it'll take a statewide vote to make that happen. So, you know, I'm just here today to talk a little bit about that. If you have any questions, you want to talk to me about it, come find me one-on-one, but really just want to be here today to bring awareness. This is coming up. Let me know if you have any questions. Again, it's Initiative 1634, Yes to Affordable Groceries. I'll work with Ollie and Sue to see if we can send out some literature to the whole listserv, but anyway, if you have any questions, let me know. Again, my name is Michael Charles. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, I'm going to introduce the outgoing director of OMWBE, but the incoming director of the Department of License, to introduce us to the new director of OMWBE. So, with that being said, Teresa.
Thank you. Thank you, Molly. So just a quick note of thanks to all of you. This job has been the greatest privilege of my career. Thank you for your grace, and a special thanks to Ollie, Vice Chair of the Advisory Committee, for her wisdom and for, as we said, pushing. That is an act of love, right? That's what we do. So thank you so much. It's a privilege, and I'm thrilled to introduce Lisa Vanderloon as your new Director of the Office of Minority Women's Business Enterprises. If it's okay with you, I'll let you let her introduce herself.
I will do that, but I want to tell a story.
Okay.
Oh, good share.
I'll never forget when the OMWBE role became, when they were looking to for a director of OMWBE. When was it, 2 years ago?
Yeah.
2.5 years ago, and Teresa had been the interim at OMWBE and working with us. And when they became time to apply, she wasn't planning on applying, and I was pushing her to apply. And she said, well, I'm a white woman. I don't think I should apply. You remember that conversation? And when I said to Teresa, I said, Teresa, I don't care if you're blue, green, or whatever. If you're working for us, understand our challenges, and in the interim role, we clearly see where you've been working on behalf of inclusion for the minority community. You don't have to be other to fight for us. And then I went on and told her my story of growing up in Mississippi and was there doing all of the marches and when Martin Luther King came through. And one of the things that I saw as a little girl was when people were coming through Mississippi marching on our behalf for rights to vote, there were very few African Americans, because if we marched or my parents marched, our house might have gotten burned down or a kid got hung, something. So it took other than us to march for our rights. And I say sometimes we get hung up on that, but we need someone that's going to fight for us, and she's done a great job. She's really streamlined a lot of things at OMWBE. And we're really going to miss you, but we know that you're going to go over to Department of License and do the same thing. So, with that being said, I'll let you. And I had her in tears on the day that we discussed her leaving OMWBE. I was like, okay, let me stop it, because I got her crying. She was really torn on leaving that agency, going to the other agency, and I didn't help. Okay, Lisa.
Hi, I'm Lisa Vanderloop, and I'm glad I'm standing in front of the podium because you probably wouldn't see me behind it. So I am thrilled to be here. As Louise said, I have received love from a lot of you in this room. Some of you are old friends of mine, and some of you I'm getting to know for the first time. So a little bit about myself, but before I tell you about myself, I want to tell you I have, in my recent capacity as Executive Director of the Commission on Hispanic Affairs, I have traveled all over the state, met with several organizations, many, and this is by far the most organized group I have come across, so congratulations. This is amazing, the way you work together, everything from the food to the agenda, the reporting out is just really well done, so thank you for letting me be a part of that. So I grew up in Eastern Washington. I'm the daughter of farm worker activists. My parents were also small business owners. They did that for a few years, and then it became too difficult. They were LEP, limited English proficiency. The paperwork was too hard for them. They loved the work, though. They loved having a restaurant. They loved being a part of the community. My mother ended up being on the city council before she passed away. They were very active in their community. And so I'm excited about this role. Teresa has laid a great foundation. And I'm hoping that what we can do going forward is continue that work and to look at what else we can do to benefit all of our communities. I love the fact that you have, your tagline is power and unity, because the one thing I do know is we're better when we're together, we're stronger when we're together, and when we all have one voice. So I'm really looking forward to working with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions for Lisa?
Teresa will ask them.
Okay. Okay, now we're going to bring up Nancy to do a presentation. I know you've been hearing everything to do with Tabor, and we're trying to really get going on our Equity Empowerment Center. Nancy is going to do a presentation today on where we are and what's needed.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So this is going to take every single person in this room to come together. And a lot of people who are not in this room, who are going to hear from you about how important and fabulous this concept is. So, and I first want to acknowledge the board. This is an amazing board. And as Lisa was saying, I've had a chance to work closely with everybody on this board, and they are incredibly hardworking on behalf of everything that Tabor is trying to do. And so I really think we should acknowledge that. So, this is the Equity Empowerment Center. It now has a name. All it needs is money now. And I'm going to talk about this from two perspectives. One is from you as Tabor members, the things that you need to know to understand why we're doing it in the way, why we're designing it in the way we're designing it. But the other one is the sales pitch, if you will, to our public agencies and our private corporations. And our public agencies are not, are struggling with understanding this. So some of these points are going to be very important to repeat back when you're sitting with a public agency who's trying to make a decision around this.
May I just say that some of us got it right away.
Yes. Some individuals inside some agencies got it right away. So this is minority community driven. That's important because there are those out there, there are public agencies who say, we as public agencies know how to do this stuff, and if we needed it, we could have done it. The difference here in our Tabor-initiated concept of building an equity empowerment center is that it comes from us. It comes from the minority community. And there's a lot of other stakeholders in the minority community, whose name I'll talk about later, who are behind this with us. This is not just Tabor, but a minority community-driven solution. What we're referring to with the EEC, Equity Empowerment Center, is a building, a space that is welcoming, warm, and designed so that you as a minority firm can come in, feel comfortable, and get the services that you need. We are talking about it in terms of any small business who wants to walk in the door is certainly welcome to use these services. But it is being designed by the information, the data, the interviews, and the input that is uniquely to what minority firms need to feel successful, supported, and have resources, okay? The idea is to have this building. Inside this building is going to be a WeWork space. Are you familiar with WeWork? Anyone not familiar with WeWork? Okay, WeWork is a popular new concept. Impact Hub is another one, Riveter is another one, where what they're doing is offering office space and or workspaces where you can rent for a day or a week or a month or a year a space to work out of. And then you'll have a sense of community around you. You have the coffee machines and all the kinds of equipment that you typically need to use. You have colleagues next to you who are there to, you know, give you support. So there are other types of these WeWork businesses out there. This one, our center, will have a WeWork concept where we want you to rent an office or a workspace, whether it's for a day or for a meeting or for a week or for a year, but it gives you a professional place to work with your friends and colleagues around you who are there to support you. So that's WeWork. There's another component of this, which is connecting individuals to training. So there's a very important policy initiative going on around our region towards making, because there are not enough workers to fill the demand for certain kinds of work, construction work, engineering, technical work. So there's a lot of political dynamism around supporting how we train those workers and connect them into jobs. So we are posing this center as a place where not only businesses can go, but people of color can go who wish to connect into the training programs and the workforce programs. That's important for us as Tabor because there's a lot of political interest in supporting initiatives like that, and there's a lot of grant money around that, okay? Plus, that's who you hire, right? We have data which tells us that that's minority firms hire minority workers, and so having highly skilled, well-trained, expert workers in the community from which you are hiring is a welcome benefit back to us as well. So this is data driven, and I'm not going to go through all the data, but we didn't just, we designed this, we meaning we sat with the board, we've sat with a lot of individuals outside a Tabor meeting to design what this thing should look like, and we use data. So when we sit with a public agency or private corporation, we're not just making up ideas of how to do this. We went and footnoted it the heck out of this about all the places of disparity studies. And there's three of them I think we cited. All of the places that they tell us that this particular solution is important to us. That this is one that's going to move the needle. We have a lot of public agencies who, and private companies, right, who say they don't need to help on something like this because they do pre-bid conferences and they advertise and they talk to you. They make sure that you know that there's a bid opportunity out there, right? If those, and they do training, right? If those things were working, we wouldn't be where we are today. That's our answer back. So we needed something revolutionarily different than just providing a technical assistance program. Okay? And let me say one other thing. So the center has this WeWork concept. It also has a service bureau concept. And this is unique. There is no other place that we have been able to find by our research that has this, which is we are going to have no cost or low cost direct business services that you can use. So that means all the stuff that your big companies that you compete against have, that is going to be sitting inside this building for you to be able to access either at no or low cost. That means when you need an attorney to help negotiate and understand a contract term, when you're having a dispute with a prime or an agency about an element in your contract, you can use that attorney at no or low cost. When it's time to do your billing, you all got to learn how to do billing and invoicing so you get paid within the 30-day window. But it's more than that. It's having a back office who can help do that, just like your big companies have. That's going to be the type of resource that you can use inside this center. And then it will host training and workshops. It'll have spaces where our public agencies and our bigger companies and primes can hold their training and can hold their pre-bid conferences. So you don't have to go into the middle of downtown Seattle and fight for parking and go into this building where it's not your building, right? This makes them come to us. This makes them come into your space to say, here's the opportunities and here's the training. So why Tabor? We get this question a lot too. And this is the crux of one of the issues that we're struggling with in our funding, is why should this be Tabor? And we hear all kinds of things from friends as well as those who are protecting their agency and their company's integrity and responsible decision making. Why Tabor? Why shouldn't we go out and compete this and make anybody who wants to do this type of concept compete with you? And if you're that good, you'll come to the top. Well, we do point out that it's not just us. So in that power of unity theme that we have this year with President Garrett, we are reaching out, and you can help us reach out to all the other organizations around who can help support this concept for us. Because this isn't just about the people in this room, right? This is about a community. So, James, NAMAC has been a warm and welcoming partner to us. And SVI, Seattle Vocational Institute, same. Civil Rights Coalition, Eddie Rye, says this is what they're about. They are all about technical assistance or support to minority firms. They are not competing with us, they are supporting us. The Urban League, a new OMWBE, have all said, we are there for you to help support you. We are not there to compete for this kind of project. So our question back to public agencies is, we are situated, we are well situated to be the ones that you choose to do this, to fund this kind of work. I've talked about the kinds of things that we know about Tabor. We've been in continuous operation since 1999. We are stable, we are respected, we are a nonprofit, we have a legacy here inside our communities, et cetera. That's why Tabor. Because we are good enough to do this. We are good enough to be able to put together a facility of this scale and make it work. Okay, I talked about that already. So this is just saying, this is being designed for what minority firms need based on things like disparity studies. Even though we will not get into an ID 200 debate, we're not going to get into an I-200 debate with public agencies about whether or not they can fund this, because we say anyone who walks in the door is welcome, but we are designing it based on what you need. Okay. So the services. So as a Tabor member or an individual might use these services, what would you get, or what would this look like for you? We're going to take you there this afternoon after we finish this discussion and show you this building, because it's absolutely fabulous and it is a place you will want to work. So you walk in the door and you will have your workspace or your office. There's a receptionist there to greet your guests and to take your mail and take your phone call. All the things that make you look like a professional business on par with the biggest of them, right? Then you have services which will be set up on retainer, which means they are gonna be there for you, whether it's one day a week or by appointment. We don't know all that yet, and we don't know the cost formulas yet. We are hoping that some of it will in fact be no cost. But for the kinds of services that you need to be able to run your business at top speed, at top performance. Okay. The other piece here is a certain energy around this. So it's not just an empty building. If we build an empty building, we failed, right? So this really sincerely needs to be something that meets a need that you are excited about, that you say, yeah, I go in this building, I can imagine myself using this space. And if we're not hitting that mark, we're not on the right plan, right? So as you go and look at this building, because y'all gonna go after this, you need to give us feedback as to what you see inside that. Do you see this as a place that you can use?
So where is this place?
This magical place is 113 over near Avenue South. It's the old Dairy Gold building. And it's really, really cool. So you walk in and it's got that rough kind of, what would you call it?
Industrial.
That's it. Industrial look. And it's got parking. It's got a major tech center down below. Pardon me? The wood beams, raw wood beams. It's really a cool space. And it's right near I-90. It's right near I-5. Really cool space. We have money for tenant improvements so that we can build out offices and spaces so that they're really nice and comfortable, and we'll make it really fancy so Elton will come and use an office there. And it really is beautiful. They have these big vestry windows and high ceilings, and it's got state-of-the-art fiber optic Wi-Fi because the prior tenants in there was a high-tech firm. So that's really cool. The money. Okay, so save your money up for the gala, because we're putting a lot of pressure on Pearl to increase the goal for the gala fundraising, and we all want you to raise your hand when it's time to raise the paddle, because that's part of our fundraising strategy. But the reason why it's important for you to be thinking about this at the gala or private donations or click on the PayPal donation button is not, it's that old familiar thing that politicians tell us. It isn't even the money, it's the show of support that comes when those who this is for show enough interest to click a button and says, I'll donate $5 or $25. We need to show our own investment in it. So we need a draft started budget where Ollie and the board is working furiously to try and get, again, private corporations and public agencies to give us big chunks of money. We need a chunk of money to open it up, and then we'll need an annual chunk of money to operate. We're imagining a director that will operate this center. We are not doing low budget. And it sounds a little corny, but it needs to be respectful space and respectful services. This is not a low budget deal because it's nonprofit social servicing. This is a respectful business professional oriented concept. So we have goals for fundraising, private corporations, public agencies, and again, our Tabor memberships. Look at the public partner list. Keep talking to them. And then we have some private companies, private corporations that we are talking with, and I don't want to list them all because we're just launching on that. Some strategies is for naming rights on the building or, a conference room or something, plaques. You know how you go into hospitals and they have plaque, right? So everyone likes to see their name, so we'll put a pretty name on a plaque. Scaled memberships, you all pay a membership fee, but maybe you'll pay, $500 a year to have access to the workspace whenever you want to walk in and have a meeting with a client. And then the gala auction. So the risks, another one everyone likes to talk about is Seattle School District, and remember Silas Potter. And so we have that public agencies who are asking us about that. How can we do it when that went sideways so many years ago, right? So we talk about how we manage those risks. The basic integrity of Tabor all by itself, it tells us this is not our issue. That is not our issue. But if you don't know Tabor, we also talk about
how we manage this. We diversified our funding sources. We're not using just one funding source, so if all the money goes away because a public agency says, I'm not playing this anymore, we're not stuck, right? So that's a risk management strategy. We're using proven models. We are used like the WeWork and the service bureau concepts that come out of community attributes. We have built these models based on predecessors and the successful models that have already been tested out in a marketplace. We use survey, we use data, we use things like that that help drive our confidence in the likelihood of success. We did our budget research, and so our goals and our cost funding is generous, but not underfunded. And then operating policies. The Urban League had to redo all their operating policies in the last 5-10 years as a result of some of these things. We use them as a starting point, but we have developed a very specific set of operating policies on behalf for Tabor that show the integrity of our operations, including things like conflict of interest and ethics and those kinds of things that they will look for. So if a state auditor comes through, they're going to see the kinds of things that they would want to see. So the time frame. By the end of June, we have some lease negotiations underway. That is the building we want you to come and look at. By the end of September, we need to have our money locked in place. We'll be drafting up our rollout campaign. And by the first of the, our goal is, if not before, to open up doors by January 1st. So there's some adjacent steps that we're doing to show Tabor to the external world that we are, in fact, that kind of professional organization that we know we are. So one of the things you're going to notice is we're starting to use constant contact, NAMAC or NAMC, I don't know which you prefer, uses this. It looks cool, right? It looks clean and professional. So when you're starting to get email blasts from Tabor and from Kayla, you're seeing now this new format. It's clean and it shows the professional integrity of what Tabor is about. It's a nice communication tool. We're updating our websites. You're going to start seeing changes on the website. We can what works and what doesn't in the proposed design, but we're working on that. We had a fundraiser, fund development consultant come in who just spent a few minutes with us and said, I look at your website and I can't tell what the mission is. And then I looked at the website and there's no place to donate. So we are going to address those things. So who we are becomes very apparent to anyone looking at a website. The board member policies are now, I think they're loaded already on the website. She's going to double check. But we have adopted, the board has adopted policies for the board and for membership. So look at the policies. They're very standard. There's nothing startling about them, but they needed to be set. And so you can go to the website and you can see the strength of those policies sitting on the website.
And I think that
one. Okay. So now you get to go see this fabulous place and prepare for the auction where you get to donate, and thank you. Are there any questions?
No, I think we need to have a discussion.
So, thank you, Nancy.
You know, I was getting very disappointed because Nancy retired from the city, but the good thing is we got her. So let's give Nancy, this is really great. And getting us to this point. As you know, this is something we've been talking about for a few years, and I'm really excited to know that we've gotten to this point, and we couldn't have gotten this far without Nancy and all of the hours that she put in to get us to have this presentation ready. But I would like to hear from you your thoughts and feedback on what you just heard. And one of the things that we're planning on doing is ending the meeting early so we can all go over and do the walkthrough together. Some of you have already done it. You were at, Ebony was at the walkthrough already. Who else? Louise has been there already, Pearl. OMWBE, but we want everyone to see why we are so excited, not just from the presentation you just heard. Lynn, we're going to be counting on you to do our build out at no charge. But this is, I'm saying this to say we will be engaging our own members to help us with this. Is Flybright still here? I was going to tell him we need some professional pictures. But we need all of your support, and we want you to be just as excited as we are. Now, I would love to hear your feedback and thoughts on what you just heard in the building and everything. Frank?
I'm familiar with that building. My dad grew up in the Garlic Gulch, and that building's right on the outskirts. I got to compliment your committee and Nancy for choosing. That's a fantastically beautiful building, very, very fit for what you're gonna do. So my compliments to you.
It goes to Anthony.
Yeah.
Anthony found it.
The business owners at NAMAX, James.
First thing I wanna do is thank you for the table for putting all this together. I mean, it's gonna make a huge difference. And the second thing I think it's gonna do is gonna give us a chance to work together as a team, you know, and that's highly needed to put together a drive where we can all work together on the one facility. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Well, as I'm helping Nancy doing the marketing strategy, I do have a vision, like from my perspective. I hopefully, like once we have opened up the center, one day we can all have this kind of meeting together in that center.
Yeah.
That will be our building for all of us, for the community.
And that's the goal. Our Tabor meetings will be there. Everything we do, when you see the space, you're gonna see we're not gonna have to rent out anywhere to have a reception anymore. All of our meetings can be there. NAMAC meeting can be there. Nancy, which one?
NAMAC.
Okay, NAMAC meeting can be there. Any of our partners, you're going to see the opportunity for everything. And the goal is to get everyone familiar. We're coming to one location for everything. So if the prime said we can't find anyone, that's not going to be an excuse anymore. Because everything, all they have to do is pick up the phone or come over there, do their pre-bid conferences, everything at one location. And we're hoping when you guys in the community get familiar with that and coming to one location, you just show up. I mean, as you can see, just coming to a Saturday meeting, what networking is all about. So when you know you're gonna come there and run into others and run into prime contractors, it's the networking just being there is gonna be great also. Business owners, your thoughts. I saw Fred hand up.
Well, congratulations everybody. I think that's an ideal location, right in our area. I've known it since I was a kid. The first biggest question to me is how much it's gonna cost. And it's going to take a lot of fundraising, not only to establish it, but to keep it going. And I hope we don't rely too much on the gala fundraising, because that's going to come in close to what we need. So I just want to be involved and volunteer anything that I can do to help raise that money.
I can buy 10 tables for the gala.
Anyone else?
You want me to answer some of that?
Well, you did. You covered it.
Yeah.
We're reaching out to state agencies, corporations, and others. This is just where the Tabor members can do their part, is at the gala and things. The outreach is just going to be ongoing.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Any feedback?
Do we know of any of the cities that are doing this? Any other companies or any other cities, any other organizations that are doing this?
Not that we know of.
Excellent.
Yeah. We were hearing it's the first in
structured this way.
Right. Beautiful.
Any other comments?
Well, so that I was just thinking, once this is created, you guys will have a game plan for others to replicate in other areas.
In other cities and states, yeah. Yeah. Okay, before we end, and if anyone needs a ride over there, let us know. I would love for everyone that can make it over to just do a quick walkthrough. It's right at Rainier before I-90. It's 5 minutes from here. I met some folks from the city there Thursday, and they said they got the car gassed up and was ready to do a 20-minute drive, and they got there in 2.5 minutes from downtown. So the location is really great, away from the traffic, right off the freeway. There's a park there. We're hoping to have a food there, coffee shop inside and on. Before we adjourn, and I cut you off from your announcement, SDOT, and if there are any other announcements before we adjourn.
Thank you, Robin. And I apologize for trying to jump in at the beginning. That's right. I'll come in my place. I appreciate it. So one, I wanted to thank everyone who showed up to the Working with SDOT Move Seattle event on June 14th. It was really great. There was a lot of attendees. We put out a lot of information about the Move Seattle projects, and hopefully it was a good opportunity for a lot of networking. I do see folks in this room who were there, and I'm really happy that you were all able to make it. Hopefully, we can have another one. We're going to have another one in October, and it will be connecting the DOTs and potentially a connection of preparing some subs to figure out how to prime or be prepared to prime contracts more.
And beginning next year, you will be having those at the Equity Empowerment Center.
That is ideal.
And great pleasure. So, what I wanted to note. In the front, we have the upcoming consultant opportunities and public works opportunities for SDOT. These are the sheets. Please pick them up. I'm updating them quarterly. If you have any questions about them, they have the project manager's information right there. So if you want to call them directly, you have their number and you have their email address. Or you can contact me and I can facilitate that type of conversation. So again, my name is Viviana Garza. Happy to help.
Viviana, has your role become permanent yet, or are they still interim?
I'm currently in interim capacity. Oh.
Don't feel bad.
No, okay.
I'm in interim capacity currently, but I'm just staying with the city in the positions I've been in.
Okay. Anything we can do to help, let us know.
One announcement, Hensel Phelps is hosting a small business outreach for all of our sound transit projects on July 11th. It's going to be at our Belgi location. Next year when we do it, we'll do it in your new center.
Thank you.
That would be fantastic. But it is it's for some bid packages for our OMWBE project that we're doing, and also we are competing on the upcoming Redmond Lake extension project, so there's some small business opportunities there. I've got flyers, and it's July 11th, so please RSVP and come talk to us about it. Thank you.
Thank you. Scanson. Please let him make a huge donation.
Thanks for the plug there. So first of all, I love the collaboration. This is fantastic. This is my second meeting, I think. But to see this come about, this is how it's supposed to work. So kudos for that. And yeah, we look forward to the center. So there's a couple things. Wanted to point out, I have a list of 11 projects. Right now we're in Seattle and around the area. There's a lot going on. We have some with the University of Washington. Jim here is a great partner with us on that. We have some things going on there that we have a lot of opportunities for everybody to get plugged in. We want open access. We want all certified firms. We want them to get plugged in. So come see me if you'd like that. I can email that to you as well. Also, training. September 20th, we're going to kick off our fall boost class. So, Skanska uses our own folks to teach subcontractors how to get in, be successful on our projects, and there's a high percentage of those folks that have attended who get in on our projects. We walk them through it, we give them scopes, packages, we build them out, they become a team player on future projects, and it's for everybody's interest. So, see me for more information.
Elton, and
Paul.
Paul. Elton and Paul, and then we're gonna.
Yeah, this idea sounds phenomenal. It would be great just to suggest into an ideal. When prime contractors, there's a lot of business, a lot of work going on, a lot of inclusion, minority inclusion on federal funded projects and whatnot, capacity. There's not enough companies around, minority businesses, small businesses, to perform this work. It would be phenomenal to get the primes when they do their outreaches and whatnot to actually be nice to have them be part of this new center and actually do their outreaches and meetings there.
Yeah, and that's the goal.
That would be great. Yeah.
That's the goal. Paul?
Yeah, so.
Yep.
Yeah. So yeah, my name is Paul Jackson, and one of the projects that I've been working on was with King County Health and CDC. They funded a lead poison awareness campaign starting out for South King County. There's a huge minority and immigrant population there. Low income, things like that. So on July 7th, there's going to be a workshop on lead poisoning that's going to be in Tukwila at the Tukwila Shag Senior Center. And so it starts at 10, it's going to go till 2 p.m., 10 in the morning, 12 or 2 in the afternoon. And you can come and get tested for lead if you have the items that you want to have tested. You can bring them. Children get tested for lead when you come. And it's open, free, there'll be food there. And so let's make an announcement. It's not business, but it's still health. So, okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. If there are no other announcements, like I said, we hope you join us and go over and tour the center right quick on your way. This, the meeting was supposed to last to noon today, so we are giving you plenty of time to still make your noon schedules or where you have to go in the afternoon. Thank you, and we'll see you next month.